Hi there, this is NextTech Insider, powered by Empiric, where we're looking to banter with some of the most eclectic pioneering minds to uncover an insider view on the tech issues that really matter, both for business and citizens. Today, I'm chatting to Brian Hills, Head of Data at the Data Lab. Brian, thanks for doing this.
Hi, Shivvy. Thanks for having me.
One thing that I've come up against, and I wonder if you share the same observation, yeah, is business leaders, whether it's organizations, governments, no matter what type of company it is, or even nonprofits, sometimes still view data perhaps as an IT thing. Is that something you could go with?
Yes, absolutely. We're still seeing a lot of that, and it's about the, you know, data is the kind of exhaust pipe of the IT function. And a lot of the things that we look at now is how do we talk about data as an asset at the boardroom? And that really has led to what we're seeing with the rise of the chief data officer. So somebody at that exec level reporting into the CEO who's responsible for data as an asset across an organization.
And Brian, clearly someone who is a CDO probably is up at night worrying about quite a few concerns to do with data privacy and that kind of reconciliation between data being meaningful from a company and helping the actual end consumer, but then also assuring the consumer of transparency and privacy. How do people reconcile the two?
Well, it's a very fast-paced emerging field at that level, and typically CDOs at the moment only last for about 2 to 2.5 years. So I think we're going through a big learning journey in this. I think one of the challenges for them is how do we get data governance and data privacy right, which are key to how we operate as an organisation, but how do we still maintain that level of innovation? How do we stay ahead of our competitors by innovating with data within the right data governance frameworks? And that's some of the key issues that does keep them up at night.
Brian, when we hear the notion of big data, to most consumers or even working professionals, the notion that comes to mind tends to be these kind of vast streams of data floating around in a parallel digital universe somewhere, just an assortment of letters and numbers. But really demystify this for us, because it goes beyond just big data. There are various types, aren't there?
Yeah, so there's lots of different types of data, Shivvy, that can be used to generate value for both companies and social impact as well. And now we tend to just talk about it as data generically, with lots of different types under that. So structured data, very well organized data, unstructured data, which could be text or images, and even small data, which is observing how people behave in their houses and understanding that insight to help drive brands.
And in fact, small data sometimes gets overlooked in the headlines, doesn't it? Because you do still find, as you say, either the article talks about data in general, or specifically big data used by businesses or governments.
Yeah.
But this kind of micro small data can actually have some actionable insights to it.
Yeah, so for example, we tend to have a picture in our heads about what millennials are and what they do, and a lot of that comes from the data and the digital services they use. But however, that's a persona of their life, it's not their entire life. And what we tend to see is lots of ethnographic studies that brands do to understand actually how do they behave in their home situations and what do they actually do. And those nuggets of behaviour, with people like Martin Lindstrom who studies this, can add lots of value to big brands.
And in terms of talent, Brian, that are either already working in the field, I want to future-proof their career, or indeed those looking to break in, because you know, data scientists, data researchers, analysts, it's quite a hot field right now, and indeed has been for some time. What kind of tip sheet might you offer them for what needs to be top of mind?
Yeah, so we typically visualise that as a radar diagram, and the axis of the radar diagram are different types of skills. So ultimately it's how you can use machine learning, how you can program, how you can communicate your results and interact, how you think about ethically how your work's going to impact down the line. And we tend to get people to understand where they are on that radar diagram and identify pockets that they need to work on. And if you're already in work, then there's lots of online training that can help you upskill in those pieces as well as introductory material as well. So there's lots of stuff online. We're seeing more and more courses come out in the public as well, so you can go and study in boot camps and others. So the types of courses that we would recommend are things like data engineering. So how do you build robust systems that can process and handle lots of data? Or courses around machine learning. So learning about the algorithms that can be used to deliver insight into a business. And increasingly there's more courses coming online about learning about the soft skills and communicating and visualising those results, because at the end of the day you can do lots of technical stuff, have great answers, but you need to be able to tell the story in a compelling way. You know, my personal opinion is there's a lot of focus on the STEM piece, but we're almost optimising that to a certain characteristic of person. I think that doesn't help us in diversity of thinking or type of person. And I think lots of people with humanities have expertise in analysing and different perspectives, ethical perspective, which is important as well, and we should be kind of embracing the wider group in here.
So Brian, I'm really intrigued to hear your take on some of the use cases for data in action that you observed in your travels or in indeed your wider work, where it's been used to create meaningful impact and sustainable sort of insights. Mm-hmm. Where do you think we should be looking for some of these really fascinating use cases?
So a lot of the use cases we see just range across all sectors and all size of company. So some of the examples that we have, one of them is from the legal services. So this is really looking at access to legal services. And in the UK, there are over 1 million unsolved cases every year. And a major challenge is 1 in 3 people or companies can't find the legal services or afford to access them. So a company that we're working with called Amicus, they're looking to use lots of historical case law, which is unstructured text, and apply natural language processing and statistical techniques to build models of that. And if somebody comes along with a new case, they can understand what action should they take. Should they actually try and pursue that legally, or are there other routes to success for them? So they're disrupting the legal space at the moment, and they're using machine learning techniques and natural language processing.
Kind of a natural marriage between data and AI.
Yeah. Another example we've seen is an industrial internet. So looking at how we measure machines with Internet of Things and how we can do predictive maintenance on those. So an example use case is temporary power generation. Now, temporary power generation is often used to power large-scale events, but it also can be used in crisis situations to help areas of need in hurricanes or areas in Africa with the challenging situations.
And so, Brian, you've alluded to preempting a problem before the issue even develops. And indeed, predictive data speaks to that in the sense of perhaps even identifying a need before the person even realizes that they have that very need.
Yeah.
What are some examples of that in action?
Okay. So a particularly interesting example is around smart homes. So these are homes that are built to enable the vulnerable to live there, and they're instrumented in a way that we can understand how they behave in that environment. And collecting that data allows us then to run lots of experiments and test hypotheses, such that scientists at the moment have a hypothesis that there might be some link between dehydration and falling. And so the building of these smart homes and people living in them allows us to have data sets that run those experiments. And the access and collection of that data is all done with agreement of the people who live in those homes.
Wonderful. So Brian, let's go into something a little contentious, and that's privacy.
Yeah.
And we're talking about obviously somehow reconciling the ethical aspect of how one's data is handled for an end consumer. Mm-hmm. And then obviously an organization needing to use it in a constructive way, in many cases anonymized aggregated data, and that's not always clear to the consumer because we feel like we're being watched. There's just a lot of murky waters here. What needs to be top of mind for us when we're thinking about privacy?
So I think it's useful to think about a parallel to this. So if we look at tech over the last 10 to 20 years, there's been amazing developments, amazing applications, and a lot of research into how we as citizens engage with phones and applications, to the extent that we're now addicted to it, apparently. Mm-hmm. So can we think of privacy in the same way? Can we set ourselves a tech challenge to say, let's leverage our learnings and techniques from the client engagement on selling stuff and actually apply it to the area of privacy so that we're making very clear communication to our customers about what they've signed up for, what their rights are, how their data is being used. And I think there needs to be a lot more focus on that particular area.
Yes, and a lot of food for thought on that. Brian, thank you for a very compelling chat today and for being in my hot seat.
Great. Thanks very much for the opportunity.
And thank you for watching.